Hey, Linda, what lesson did you just have?
Hey, Drake, I just had business. We were learning about the benefits of promotion. What about you?
I just had business, too. What are the benefits of promotion, then? Time to test your knowledge.
Some fantastic things over the next hour and a half and three quarters with a small interlude. Just at the back, there's some... You haven't tasted it. That was done by our Year 9s. I did an Alan Sugar-style challenge to them, and they rose to the challenge magnificently, which I'm really impressed with. Just want to start off before I launch off with the first bit and just give you a little bit of feedback from our staff, because we've run two TeachMeets so far, internal TeachMeets. And the comments on the board, I'll let you read them themselves, are basically replicated across all the staff that have attended our own internal TeachMeets, and they have been the most well-regarded bits of CPD that we've done in the last 12 months. Nobody in our leadership team had any involvement whatsoever, just completely done by the staff with their own experience, their own classroom practice. And some of the comments there, I think, speak for themselves. What I would like you to do in terms of taking away from this at the end is set it up in your own schools. Get your own internal teacher meetings running. Get teachers to share their ideas. Get them to trial those ideas. Some of them might not work in different lessons, some of them will work better than others. Encourage more people to come to the next TeachMeet. We plan to do the next TeachMeet in November. Might not be at this venue, but again, it will be a Kent and Medway TeachMeet. And it will be organised similar to this, and we'll be looking for presenters. So if you identify some outstanding practice, some great practice, please push people, put them forward, get them up here. It's certainly going to be a big part of certainly young and inexperienced teachers' repertoire of their training over the next few years, certainly with the schools that I've spoken to in the last few years. So, that's it from me. I'm now going to present my 7 minutes slot, okay, hopefully less, if you're ready. I'm Andy Minchin, I'm Deputy Head at Thomas Aveling School. I'm going to basically go through just a quick run through of some of the ideas, partly developed by my wife, developed by me, and something that we've used together. It's about developing the most able students, and not necessarily most able students just in grammar schools. It's about developing able students in any setting. And it comes from trying to develop the three top things of the slide there, the creating, evaluating and analysing, and coming up with some abstract ideas, some challenge questions. So it does come from Bloom's taxonomy. There's the first one. I did have a cabbage to bring along, but I forgot it. Okay. My wife's currently chopping it up, cutting it. 2 years ago, when I first shared this particular challenge question with staff, the following Christmas I got given 6 cabbages from Santa. Okay. Now, it's about trying to apply different random things to a lesson. So this one is about looking at cabbage and trying to apply it to different parts of learning. So it's obviously green, it's got veins, it's got different stems, it's got layers. How can you apply them? How can you break down the lesson that you've just studied and apply it to the cabbage? Can you use it in any way to demonstrate it? The what-if scenario. Saw this in a lesson last week. Amazing different ideas to do with genes. What if certain things never happened? It's starting to challenge the most able to think in a very, very different way. What if we burn all the fossil fuels that we have on the planet? Just so easy to add to any lesson, to give us an extension, to give us a challenge question while you're thinking about something, or as an extension homework. Think of a dog. Okay, random one. How does a dog relate to this particular lesson? It's not easy to do that. It takes real deep thinking to really make sure that you can apply it to a lesson. It might be hard. So if today's lesson was a food recipe, if we're looking at the stuff at the back, trying to apply it to what you've learned in a lesson, has it got a particular element in the middle, gooey, that links to a lesson? Right? Trying to come up with different ideas. This one, I think, is the one that we don't do enough of in lessons, and this is about trying to apply what we're learning to the real world, and then ranking them, which thing we learned today that's the most important to the real world. You know, it might be that they say, well, none of them are, but that's not the question. The question is rank them. And they've got to explain their choice, which is a difficult one. So again, we're using the top end of the Bloom's taxonomy, starting to evaluate. Next one is about disadvantages. So list four disadvantages of a particular topic, right? And then come up with ways of getting over those disadvantages. That's a really hard thing to do. Again, it's evaluating a topic, but it's being creative, trying to come up with creative solutions. So again, I'm focusing in on that Bloom's taxonomy. The final one is basically linking drawing. Now, this one I'm going to just basically set my thing going. And it's basically linking drawing with the lesson, getting them to come up with something creative that actually links to the lesson. Now, it's not easy. Some of the drawings are going to be quite poor quality sometimes, but they'll get better at it. And obviously, we do know that if we start to use the creative side of our brain, we are starting to use both sides of the brain. We're turning text into pictures. Right? It's starting to become more concrete learning. This is an add-on to do with the drawing. This is a package that I've tried today, 7-week trial, and you know, some amazing things where you can get students to do their own work, record it, select images, and different type of homework. And again, it's just developing those different types of skills. I'll leave you with that, let that finish. There's some key messages to do with TeachMeet ongoing, and I'll let you have a look at that at the end. The key thing about this we're going to keep it really short and sharp, and we're certainly going to make sure that you don't go over 7 minutes. If it's between 2 and 7 minutes, it doesn't matter. But good luck, everyone. We are going to have one person coming after me that we've already pre-selected. The rest of you, it's going to be random, those of you that are presenting. Good luck, and I look forward to hearing some new great ideas. Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay, now this is where the randomising comes in. The idea is that I will do this completely at random. studies teacher. They are creating their own band, their own group, and to kind of teach them about the power of social networking and about promotion and marketing, I said to them as a plenary, so literally 15 minutes at the end of the lesson, I said, I want you to create a Facebook page for your new artists or your new bands. And literally, within seconds, they didn't even need to watch the tutorial. They couldn't, unfortunately, embed YouTube videos because that's blocked in our school. But I said to them, if you email it to me, if you tell me the video you want, I'll embed that for you. You can set this at homework. If you don't have computers in you, you haven't used of ICT in your lessons, it's fine. Set it as a homework, and they can do it as a homework activity. And they can make it as big as they like. It's fantastic. And then literally, they can email you the link, and then you can check their homework. It's paperless, but I probably will kind of use this as evidence of their planning for their work that they're doing for their portfolio. So it's really good. This is just an example. It's a really quick one. Literally, he did this in 15 minutes. So his artist was called Martin Sugar, and he's just kind of created a friends list. I love it. They absolutely love it, and you can be really imaginative with it. And I can see you using this in not just media studies, but English, history, business studies, whatever. There's loads, so much you can do with it. This one's quite good. This one is an arcade game generator, and it's basically, if you've got quizzes existing already in your subject area, you can literally upload the quiz, and then you can create a game. Okay, so this one, for example, is on French holidays of MFL year. And the idea is that you literally will allow you to upload your quiz and then the students can play the game. This one's quite good because it starts off quite simple, and the idea is you just have to hit the targets. It's like a shot, you have to hit the shot. When you progress to the next level, the targets start moving, and then the idea is that they have to try and shoot those. So that's quite a good one, which the students like. But there's all sorts of ones that you could use there. This one is what I've been using as my randomizer. If you want to have an activity in a lesson where you don't want the same people putting their hands up, you want to randomize it, you literally copy and paste your class list into this this website, and it will create a randomizer for you. It will randomize the names, and then you can remove the name once they've been chosen. So the idea is that it's not the same people that keep coming up again and again and again. And it's just a really good way of not relying on people putting up their hands and making sure that everybody in the lesson gets a chance to contribute. What is really good about this is that you can select a soundtrack as well, so you can have whatever you like. I mean, the idea is that you can upload stuff as well, which is really good. I'm trying to be really quick because I don't want to go over 7 minutes, although I don't think Stuart is actually timing me. Fake tweets, this one's brilliant. This one is excellent for plenary. If you've had a lesson where you've been looking at a specific character in a novel, or you've been focusing on a particular character in history, and the idea is that you want to try and get students to empathise with them, then they can literally send fake tweets. They can come up with a really clever username, put their real name in. That's important because that links to Google or some other image bank. And then the idea is that you send the tweet, and then you submit it, and it will upload the tweet as that character. So, for example, with my Year 13s, we are doing something at the moment on submarine in media studies, and we were looking at Richard Ayoade. So I just put one in where I pretended that I was Moss from the IT crowd, who is Richard Ayoade, and then I just kind of put in a really funny, it could be just like a one-liner that kind of gets them to think about, how is a character feeling at a specific moment in time? If you were that character, what would you tweet? That kind of thing. So that's another one. This one's really good. It's a timeline generator. You can kind of see what it does there, but the idea is that you could ask students to research a particular time in history or something like that, and they can create timelines. Literally, they go onto this the webpage, and they can just put the information in. They can create it. You can create it for them. It's really useful. Sorry. Right. No, this is the best one. Right. This one is going to revolutionise me as a media studies teacher. It's fantastic. Media studies is all about terminology. And in order to score really high grades in media, you have to use key terminology. And I'm sure it's the same in any of your subjects. This is fantastic. If you send students an essay, you give them a list of keywords they have to use in that particular essay. So you upload the keywords, then you copy and paste their essay that they've emailed you into this machine. You click check, and it will tell you how many times they've used those keywords and give them a percentage. Fantastic. This will change, my approach to teaching my media studies students. It's absolutely fantastic because you tell them to use key terminology, but they don't always do it. So that is probably one of the
with this, what it is you can be in groups straight from remembering all the way through to creating. And sentence styles allows them to roll a dice, have a think about it, have a think of time, and try and actually create a question on a specific topic. So, for example, up here, for example, this is overview. My class did this as a plenary, and then following that, we used the questions as a start of the next lesson. Yes, that's pretty much it. What I did is I put my students into groups of ability groups from obviously from remembering, understanding, all the way through straight to creating. What I did though was I left out the last one because it allows them to kind of move up through stages over a course of lessons that they're using it. So it's something that we found that worked really well and the students enjoyed as well. I think at the start there was a bit of teething problems where I just gave them something to throw at each other. But after a couple of lessons, they kind of got used to it and knew that when that was up on the board that they had to get to their colour groups. And it was something that they really enjoyed. And I think using it as, using the questions as a start of the next lesson, they quite liked as well because they could either use it in their groups or challenge other groups as well. So maybe the green group would make questions for the group below. And so on. So they can actually not only use it for their groups but use it for others as well. And here's pretty much where I got it from. I just think you've asked about the problem. I think they are £10 for a set, but the website itself actually gives you some tips on how to use them, any ideas that you can have with them, and just some general examples as well. But I mean, it's something I found to be really interesting. And
I'm Kate Rector, I'm Head of History at the MAP. I'm just going to share with you some simple assessment strategies that we use on the pop. Some are quite straightforward and they're all kind of quite good. First thing we do in our department is we try and share work that we think might be outstanding. Publicly. So, for example, this is a photograph of one of the boards in our department that we change on a weekly basis. So, if a student writes an outstanding piece of work, it's quite easy to sort of show it through the photograph and blow it up onto a wall and to just display it. A couple of the kind of impacts that we've noticed is that it's quite a good motivator for students wanting to try and get their piece of work on the work of the week. What I've got up there as well, as you can see, I've kind of write down the criteria about why that particular piece of work is outstanding, and so on and so forth. Another thing that's quite important, I think, if you choose to do something like this, is not to always pick the obvious student. So, for example, some students might not always get the A star or the A on the piece of work, but they might have demonstrated the school particularly well. And so to maybe demonstrate or display their piece of work to show them to make them feel good and to want to work harder. That's one thing. Another thing we do, and I'm sure we all do this anyway, but there are different ways of doing it, is also to share assessment requirements with them. The AS and A2, I suppose, we all share generic marks, schemes and so on. This is something that we do for our Key Stage 4 students. So we put together a kind of top tips sheet for what they might need to do on their exam. I know there are certain units in GCSE history which have very specific requirements for each question, how many minutes you need to spend on it, which particular skills they need to demonstrate. And we simply get them to glue them in front of their exercise books. And they become quite, they use them all the time, so the top tip sheets is something that we refer back to. But the key thing again with this one is to have the greatest impact is not to simply use it after the event, but to enable them to have access to it and to use it regularly before they take the assessments. The third one is something that we've been trying to do in our department and it seems to be having an impact. We tend to find that when we ask students to peer or self-assess, they're quite reluctant to embrace it fully because they, until they get the teacher's mark, they sort of feel, well, this isn't right, whatever I put on this piece of paper, I want to see what my teacher thinks. So motivational essay. But when you do your feedback lesson, if you want to do self-peer assessment, if you give them a blank copy that you photocopied and you tell them, don't worry, I have marked it, you will get your mark, we've found that they will embrace it a bit more kind of fully and trust themselves and so forth. And the outcome of that is that generally when they get the piece of work that I've marked, it's usually maybe a mark or two different, but they're usually quite accurate in identifying the key things that they need to improve. And if you do that over a period of time, I'm not suggesting you do this all the time, but if you do that particularly at the start of a new course or a new year group, they learn to trust themselves and each other. So when you want to do self-peer assessment later on, they feel a lot more reassured, I suppose. The third one, I'm sure all of us use highlighters and so forth, particularly when doing feedback lessons. Again, go through your work and highlight where you've used explanation or where you've used historical evidence or evaluation. But what we've been doing as a department, which again seems to have quite a big impact, is before you can get them to submit their work. So for example, if you take a photograph of a 15-mark politics essay from the year 13 student that she wrote for me the other day, but before I got them to submit the work to me at the end of the lesson, I asked them to highlight where they think they have used explanation. And it's quite interesting because it has a number of effects. First of all, it identifies to me when I'm marking the work whether that student actually knows what explanation is. And there are certain skills, particularly in history and in politics, which I obviously teach as well, which are quite difficult for students to distinguish between. So, for example, the difference between, say, explaining the concept and evaluating it. And so if you can get them into the habit of being able to identify in their work what they think they're doing it, it's going to enable you to give them more valid feedback and more impactful feedback, because you know that this student or as a class, they really don't know what I mean when I say you need to explain more, you need to evaluate more. And then the last one is an idea about analogy. This is a brilliant photograph, I'll explain it. I always encourage, you know, people in my department, if you want to use analogy when trying to teach a particular skill, I think it can be quite impactful, particularly in subjects like history where it's very content based. Sometimes if a student isn't understanding a particular skill, again, if I use the example of historical explanation, what you can do is try and take them a step back away from, say, the content of the lesson, to use something very simple to try and teach them what you mean by the skill. So, for example, this was a Year 10 lesson, and they've written an essay for me on the causes of the French Revolution. One of the key causes is the impact of the First World War on Russia. But what a lot of them failed to do, they knew why the war caused the revolution, but they failed to articulate that in the essay. So what I did was, right, let's step back a minute, let's forget about Russia, let's forget about the revolution. And I used the analogy of a shot being fired. And there being a death. And I asked them, well, you know, what happened in between? And got them to write out, you know, shot in the head. And then you can, once they get the skill, you can then reapply it to the content of the lesson. That's it, thank you.
Okay, for those of you who wanted to follow me on Andrew is there, it's at rob.dash. I'm a head of media studies at the Canterbury Academy nowadays. So what I would like to show you is some really free, some really easy, and some really simple tools that I've used in my classrooms, and that I've also encouraged other staff, newer staff, older staff as well, to develop that help me. So yeah, let's do it. So the first one is Prezi, which is some of you might be familiar with it, so I apologize if my teachers need to. So I came for it a bit, but I use this now instead of PowerPoint, and I encourage the students to use it also. It comes with, I've said 32 gig, it's not, it's actually 100 gig of storage. You can actually pay for upgrades, although, to be honest, it's unlikely that you'd need to. It's basically an online cloud presentation software. So actually, you could be sitting on the beach in Jamaica doing your Prezi on any subject that you like reading kind of your next planned lesson, but so is that. You can also embed videos directly from YouTube. Now, I know you can do this with certain elements of PowerPoint as well, but for Prezi, I'll show you a couple of examples. You can actually drop in the video straight away, which then encourages speed of lessons and not having to faff around to get some videos, dragging them across and all that kind of stuff. You can also download images and PDF websheets straight away to it, and as well, all those PowerPoints that you've made, you don't have to scrap them, you can just import them. It just presents it in a slightly different way. It's non-linear. My mind works very much like a Prezi, and I find that the students that I've taught this to, it takes them 2 seconds to do it, and actually they'll present their homeworks, their classworks, their courseworks like this, and some examples will actually take this as evidence as well. You can download it as a CD, as a flash drive as well. So this is Prezi, it's very quick though. Next one, some of you might be familiar with QR codes. This is the website I use for it, it's called qrstuff.com, and I'll show you in a second. Basically, you're creating digital barcodes. I know you were talking about QR codes earlier. You can use them for classroom displays. Basically, it will be a link to another, well, whatever you want, and I'll show you some examples. You can have video, you can have pre-made text messages, you can have pre-made emails, links to your email address, links to your Twitter feed, or to Twitter accounts. Whatever it is that you want to link it to, you can link it to Dropboxes as well. Contact information, videos of staff, students doing work, whatever it is that you can do. QR code is just like a shortcut to it. So if I can show you, how can I tap between the website? So this is the website here. If you apologise while I sit down for a second. So you can actually link to Google Maps as well. So you can link the geography, you can link in to your location, Twitter feed, Facebook, if you're that inclined, Dropbox, telephone numbers to school web pages. Literally, you can customise it. If you fancy putting them on t-shirts or even ties, you can have your own videos or whatever linked to your ties or even to your t-shirts. So this is Prezi again, it's like I said, non-linear. This is an example. This is on the door of a classroom. Basically, students could scan this, parents could scan this for open days, open evenings, and up could pop a video of your department doing the presentation, song and dance, whatever you'd like you want to do in your department. Examples of students' work, so students could, or parents could be walking around with their tablets, smartphones, whatever, scan it in, and up could come an example of students' work straight away. Another tool would be things like one student's books. You can encourage a student to make QR codes in the bottom right-hand corner to then have links to videos. So instead of annotating the video, we do a lot of media studies, so I can scan the video, see the video, whilst they've got their annotations around it. For me, I found it a really useful tool.
How many
48
seconds?
Okay. The next one is, depends how brave you're feeling, this is a free polling piece of software called Poll Anywhere. I've used it for my year 13s as opposed to my Key Stage 4 classes. Basically, it requires the students to do a texting, a result, or texting an opinion. You can use open or closed questions. Basically, creating a questionnaire, getting live feedback straight away. You can also email that as a link, so you don't actually have to have students out with their phones. You can set that as a homework, or I could do a Poll Anywhere as to feedback for this right now if I set it up. I'm happy to show you people later. So that's the one that I use. Again, it's all free. I'm very tight, I don't like paying for stuff, so everything that I've used is free. So this is an example of it. It's a student feedback here. So you've got What do you think of the classroom teacher, or whatever it is, differentiate, beat it, level, engage, difficult classes, and so on. So, last one. Come on, zip through. I've got time to do this one very quickly. I've literally just found this. Some of you might be familiar with it. It's called Erasmus. It is an augmented reality app for your iPhone, which basically brings videos to life. You scan a picture, say of myself, and you can have a video of me doing something else. So you can have lots of different things. That's a lot to fit into something else. Alright, so any questions, I'm more than happy to go through, but obviously find me at rob.dash.
Hello. If you don't understand what I'm saying because of my strange accent, read the words behind me. I'm going to talk about this very simple website called Meet Mary. I like simple things because I'm a bit simple myself. And it allows your students to record up to five things about the lesson. And at the same time, allows also teachers to track their students' progress. So the aim of this website is basically, the original idea was based on keeping a log of what happens in your lesson, but let's face it, who really wants to keep a log about the lesson? It's a bit like strange thing to do. So there are other things that you can do with MeMari, and here are some ideas. I mean, teachers can ask students like five specific questions about their work so that they can assess how much they've learned in the lesson. They can also keep track of the student's progress as long as it is done frequently. And it's a very good tool to communicate with your students outside of the classroom. And also, and I've used it as well, it's good to set homework, which it's paper-free. And so it's quite simple, organized, and it works very well. So students, on the other hand, they can self-evaluate their learning. They can record any relevant events about the lesson, if they might be a bit geeky, so they like to say, I've done this, done that, and then they can go back and look at what they've done. And also, they can feedback about the learning, informing so the teacher's planning. Okay? So there's quite a lot that you can do, and I like it because it's a very versatile website, so you can basically choose different things and you can explore different ways of using it. So the way it works is very, very simple. First of all, you need to go to the website, which is edu.mimari.com, and the first thing you need to do is to enter an email address or a username, and then the second step, the next step, is to choose a password. Once you are in, they will give you a teacher's code, and you need to use this and pass it to your students. So as they create their own account, you will be able to have access to their own account. So basically, the teacher's account and the student's account are joined. So this is the way you can see basically all the things that they write on your lessons, which can be a bit like a scary thing to do, but you know, sometimes it's a good thing. This is what I've done with my year 8 class, and this was before preparing them for the end of the year exams a few weeks ago. So I came up with five questions about topics that would have been in their exam, and also grammar points that again would have been the test. So I wanted to know how much they knew about this, and so once they are aware of the questions, they go to their account, and they basically have to enter their five answers to my questions in those five boxes. So by clicking on the box and typing in their answer, and also saving it by clicking on the green tick, all the work, all the answers will be then sent to my account. And this is what I see once the students have all entered, you know, their own answers. And this is the class overview. So it gives me an idea of how much they know, or what really needs to be revised, and helps me also with my planning. So, like I said, I mean, there is more that you can do with this, and I do like it because it's so simple and it's very straightforward. The kids enjoy using it. Not everyone finds it easy. So someone says, oh, I really couldn't do it, I couldn't log on. But I would say most of them don't have any problems. And I like the fact that you can communicate with them also outside of this. And so it's like texting each other messages, but it's about the learning. So it's an ongoing learning situation, which is very, very good. If you are interested in it and you want to try it because you feel very confused by what I just said, then you should refer to YouTube. There is a very, very clear video which explains step by step how to create an account and also all the other things that you can do with it. Thank you.
Okay, so what I'm going to talk about very quickly is a concept called flipped password. This is something that I've been looking at probably the past year now. And it's really just my interpretation, there's lots of interpretations of the flipped password. And the reason why I was so interested in this idea is that 90% of internet traffic is video content. And you start to look into this and you start to think about how long and how much time students spend on the internet, Facebook, Twitter, and social media, how it really is embracing them and how it's engaging them. And I think as teachers and a teaching community, I think we really need to step away from the fear that social media is negative and there's so many sort of safeguard issues. Yes, we are aware of that, but we do need to start embracing that. So that's one of the reasons why I started looking into this. Video content on the web is 50% viewed on mobile technologies. That's probably going to rise to 66% in the next few years. 28% of all Google searches are based around a YouTube search, and that starts to start me thinking that if over a quarter of the searches on Google are based around video content, what are we doing in our lessons to really embrace that and to engage the students in that video content that they're obviously searching for? Over 1 billion unique users visit YouTube every month. That's a huge number. When you think about how many students are actually in your class, going home of an evening, watching videos on YouTube, yes, most of them, some of them might not be educational, but they're going onto YouTube. They're using that media to find information, to find and then apply that information, transferring that into knowledge. And that's something that I wanted to capture in my lessons. This is the best one. An internet user watches 186 videos on average per month. Now, even if you take it down to some kind of half of that, that's a huge number of videos that students are watching. Now, can we start to actually take this technology and start to apply our content that we deliver in the classrooms via this medium? 6% of all visitors watch the video content before they read the text on a website. Okay, fantastic. Can we start then to embed videos, create these videos, put them on our learning platforms, put them on our social networking sites, or areas online where students can begin to access them? And this really brings me to the main point of this, that for me, social media is massive, especially when we're looking at video content. Video streaming services such as YouTube, and that's the thing that we really need to embrace. Students are already engaged with that. We need to now educate ourselves and start to be more innovative, perhaps, in the way that we actually positively embrace these new technologies here. So the idea about the flipped password, we've got some takes on this. You might be familiar with some of the Khan Academies, that kind of that similar concept. iTunes U as well. And the idea is that you're flipping the traditional classroom model, where instead of setting traditional homework for students to do at home, questions page 17, questions 1 to 10. When you do that, 9 times out of 10, they're going to get stuck at some point, they're going to go to their textbooks and they're just going to copy their answers out. My idea was, well, let's actually flip this whole idea. Let's give them the content via a video that I've made, one of my colleagues has made, give them that they can watch at home. At home, they can make some notes. They might be thinking about, they might use some memory tools to start to just become more aware of that content. And then in class, what we start to do is actually flip the model. We start to, instead of giving them the lecture in class, we're doing what we would do at home, the task at home in class. So there's more teacher one-to-one support from the teacher, there's more peer-to-peer support as well. And the students are more engaged in the content because they come to lesson, they feel more prepared because they've already watched some of that content at home. And that's the general idea of flipped classroom there. So the students watch that content-rich video at home, at their own pace, they can communicate with peers and teachers. I use an educational social networking site called Edmodo, so I'll create a video, upload it to Edmodo, the students can discuss among themselves on there, they can discuss with me, and there's always a built-in quiz at the end. So before the next lesson, I've got some assessment data. I can then use that data to perhaps plan or tailor the lesson. So when they come into the lesson, there's always going to be three or four groups of tables for different tasks, and I can allocate students to work on particular tasks based on what they haven't done so well at home. So in the class, I'm less of someone standing in front of a lecturer, and I'm more of a facilitator of learning. We had lots of aims and goals and objectives. I'm not going to spend too much time on this, but our main goal was to create a teaching and learning environment that creates responsibility, ownership, collaboration, and personalisation, and increases one-to-one support both from a teacher point of view and from a peer point of view. So it's really going to that idea of embracing this technology. Again, I'm not going to spend too much time on this, but this is what we did. We defined the problem. The problem was that students weren't doing it as well. They couldn't do it in their home learning. What they do a lot, they watch a lot of videos. Okay, let's flip that around. Let's put my content, spending about 10, 15 minutes of a lesson, pretty much lecturing them. Let's put that into a video format. We trialled a few of these. We've got some student feedback. And now, across our GCSE, we've rolled out a whole syllabus where every topic has a video podcast or a podcast to go alongside that. We start to upload them to our VLE, to our Modo. We start to get some quizzes built into that, so not only they watch it, they can make their own notes in however they want, thinking about memory tools, mind maps, whatever they want. There is a quiz. I've got some assessment data. I can use that data to enhance and tailor my lesson that I will see them on the next lesson. Okay, so this is just a quick video of some of the videos we've produced so far. So we started off just by kind of having a PowerPoint that I would produce. I'd record that, and then pretty much I'll narrate over the top.
What exactly is data? Well, let's have a quick look. Remember, data consists of raw facts and figures, so readings from sensors, survey facts, etc.
So assumptions like that.
Is changing all of that. Brow is a special type of writing that blind people need for feeling raised dots on paper.
So let's look at files on removable media, such as USB sticks and memory sticks. Many people work on different computers, so need a way of storing and transferring files.
As I walk past the site, I noticed that there were many observations on the data type graph.
So we turn the lots of data types across
common data types.
15 key places throughout our school.
Now we need the formula group. The formula appears in the formula bar. For example, if that's at the top of the page now. The spreadsheet can more than just display data in a new way. Some results will contain a mathematical formula.
The journey that they're familiar with. And that's kind of where we're at now. Now, I'm not saying that's perfect. That probably is not perfect for my students. Some of them like it. Some of them still don't think that's the best way. But let's find out what they do say.
I'm a PE teacher at the 100 Food School. What I'm going to show you today is a nap while we're doing a computer set. I'm working with my year 13 at the moment, so we're doing motion analysis, so it's a specific thing for them at the moment, which you could use it for any new thing. The basic idea would be to show an item model performance and then relate their performance against it. Food sets is free, so just download it from that. I basically will get the students to come in, video an ideal scenario, and then compare and contrast their performance with that. So the whole idea with it is that I'm going to give students the iPad. They come in, they video it, they assess, they can do peer assessment, self-assessment, and pick up key coaching points, and then try to improve it from there. Hopefully you can see the application will be for any practical subjects. What I'll quickly go through, I'll do it in sort of like real time, so they'll come in. Now the top red button, as you can see, you literally know, we'll press on that button and I can video. Now the idea over a period of time is to create a bank of videos of ideal excellence. So hopefully, at the moment we do it in our school, we've got a camcorder, you know, general care areas, we've got every single sport, every single skill, and they video game is excellent. Now for this one, I've got myself. I was the best badminton player in the actual class. I'm really simple, but to a certain degree, that's it. So that's me playing badminton. Now it's not the ideal graphic model, so if there was any county players in, you can pick a lot from them. Now what we can do from this point here, now if I'm looking now to play, now for a coaching point of view, now, I would say that's probably a fairly good coaching position. So from what I do, let the students now try picking this out. I can now start looking at angles, looking at my arm, etc. If we want to add some numeracy in there, You can also start talking about command group. Now, for a good coaching point, if I'm teaching support them on left arm up, looking at the badminton shot is a great example. Now, if I'm using that one, we get an overview. We can now compare that to the other videos. So what we've got now, we've got two videos we can compare and contrast them. Now what we're getting the students to do now is just come in, everyone to video each other. I've literally just sat there, so somebody's videoed me as the ideal model, somebody's videoed, friends videoed Lewis on the right hand side. So where are we filming? Now, what we can say now in coaching positions, so this is where I get now. So if I've been observed at the same time, they've got to set the video up, and they can give feedback to each other. So at this point, now, hopefully from this, if you don't play badminton, you can immediately see that his arm position there is extremely low. So we've got his... So his angle there, we can start comparing and contrasting his angle down there. So his arm's completely down there. And that was a key coaching point. So in this video, he gave some peer feedback to his friend. The friend of the video said that Sarah's got a great position in there. Your left hand's down. You've just changed as a key point. He put his arm up. There's another key point is his front arm is all outside. And he was giving feedback through that area. And literally, we can go from him to compare and contrast. Now, over a period of time, the idea is to create a bank of ideal excellent models so students can come in, look at their performance, look at my performance, self-assess, peer-assess, and then basically just go through and use the app. And that's basically it. But what you can do, look at it, hopefully there's any practical subjects there, you can hopefully do maybe with RAM or with your arms going everywhere, etc. But try and think about how you'd use it in your subject specific, but that's the area. It's been extremely successful so far in the promotion.
Okay. Well, I've got a low-tech presentation actually. I tried to log in last night onto my iPad to do this, and then I realised it wasn't my iPad, so I was conscious of it. It was kind of time that I realised that I'd run out of Jack Daniels as well. What's wrong with this? Traffic light lolly sticks. As you can see, it's a really, really low-tech solution, so it's not like something you actually see today. And I nicked this, I pirated this from Dylan Williams. And if you've all seen like, Classroom Experiment or read Inside the Black Box, you'll know about Dylan Williams. And I guess as Scott Mills would call him, he's Dylan Williams off of Assessment for Learning. Okay? And he looks a bit similar to me because he's got a not very much hair and he's got a bit of a goatee beard. My son's called what I do in my classes is I get them all to write their names down on some knowledge sticks with their target levels on. And then I use these in lessons to reinforce certain aspects of the lesson. And I've got some pictures of my kids there in the lesson where they're looking at something and assessing themselves using these knowledge sticks. So I've nicked the idea that Dylan Williams used, which is just a randomised way of choosing students to make sure that different students and answer questions, that you don't just get the same students all the time putting their hands up and answering the questions of more confident ones or more able ones. So you can pick on students throughout the class. But what I've done with my lolly sticks is I've actually traffic lighted them. And so, in my pot of lolly sticks, I've got students who, from my data, I know are working and making inline progress, so they're on the amber. And those that are working above their target level at the moment need to be even more stretched, and they've got a green lolly stick in my pot. And I've also got some students who are not performing quite so well, who've got a red lolly stick in my pot. And so whenever I come to do anything in my lesson, it could be that I use this for a question and answering session. It could be that I use this for checking whether they've done their homework. I could use this for a starter. I could use this for choosing groups. I might use this for checking understanding throughout the lesson. But wherever I do it, if I take students' names out of my pot, then taking like a cross section across the classroom. So I'll ask somebody a question taken out Tuesday's name here, so I've asked him Tuesday, and also the question what I've picked out. First of all, get students to tell me what their target grades are, so their target grades are written on their lolly sticks. And I ask the other students, when the student replies to my question, to say whether or not the answer they've given is at their target level. So has she given me a C grade answer, or has she given me a B grade answer in the way that she's replied to my question? Hopefully with my more able students, or my students who are working already above their target grade, I try to come out with some more rich questions, and so questions where it involves some more explaining, and evaluating, and linking things together. But I also that way can check that students who I know are underperforming, my rich students, have also done their homework, that they've taken part in the start of other parts of the lesson. So it's just really a randomised device, just to make sure that you get like a cross-section of the students in your lesson, including those who are working above and below their target. That's it for me.
Mine is low tech because mine involved a paper, for which I apologise. In our school, what I want to do is just to talk to you very briefly, you'll be pleased to know, through a marking system that we've employed within my school, which is Rochester Map. In our school, we use the WWEBI system, so what went well, even better way to mark people's work. So, good features, target areas for development. And one of the key things that we found that wasn't necessarily happening as a result of that was students being out having the opportunity to actually review their EBIs. So I might set them a target and say, next time do this, but it might be a week or 2 weeks until they picked up that topic again, in which case there are sometimes issues with students recalling that and being able to apply that to a new piece of work. What I did in my classroom was decide that instantly I would have those targets being acted. So because, and only because, I happen to have a packet of blue paper next to me, I decided that what I would do is each time I gave back a piece of mark's work, it would have a clear EBI on it, and the students would then undertake what we call the blue review, for obvious reasons. The idea of this is that as a response to that, so sometimes as a starter activity based on the feedback they've got in the lesson, or sometimes as a homework activity, they then undertake a review of that particular piece. In some instances, it might be a whole piece of work, depending on what it is. In others, it might be you might need to add this section, you might need to use this particular skill, in which case the students just use that there. It doesn't necessarily mean that what you're doing is marking everything more than once, because what I tend to do is employ a range of different things. So it might be that the students peer assess one another in the first instance, and then they are doing their blue review in response to that peer assessment, and then I will then mark to hope the overall packet of assessment. Or equally, sometimes it's the other way around. So I might mark the first piece of work, and they might then blue review in response to that, and students are then looking at the work to see if they are able to show that they've acted on that target. Because I'm a bit of a geek, I then decided to do the super blue review for the students who haven't quite got it yet, which is an even darker paper on the back of this pack. But the idea is that students can A, see that there is an instant feedback response. Marking is definitely a dialogue, it goes back and forth between the teacher and the student, or student and the student. And equally, I know it sounds silly having it on coloured paper, but when you look down a whole folder of the work of work, you can see instantly where all of that review work is. So that's your progress being evidenced immediately there. This has now become a policy within our department. It's then been taken out into other departments with various different coloured pieces of paper. So we have the pink briefing in history and the green what have you not seen in geography. And obviously you can then go ahead and make up your own bizarre versions of that. But what we found is it's really useful and it's become an automatic part of the process within our school. Students say, do I blue review this straight away? I have a drawer of paper that's there and ready to go. It carries no ostensible photocopying costs with it because I'm not preparing a special review sheet that they then fill in. Literally, all it means is that every now and then I have a drawer of blue paper and conversation. But other than that, it's a really good way of getting students to act on their feedback instantly. If you use exercise books, you can do it with different coloured pens, something like that. But it's a really simple way of anybody who comes into our department and wants to look at our marking, being able to see that students act in there.
I'm going to talk to you about a student response program on constructive.
pretty simple. All you do, put your email in and put a password in and you can do it next time. It's the simplest way to do it. Right. So, if I go down to quiz-based activities, I've made a few quizzes already. There's a few different ones you can do. You can do a space race, which is quite fun. You can set basically your class up into teams, and like little rockets go up and down the screen, across the screen, and they race from one end to each other. So if they get questions right, the rocket goes a little bit further across the screen, and they go to teams and they can win it. It gets quite competitive. What I'm going to show today is just a normal quiz, because I want the questions to actually come up on the screen. I'm going to do it as a teacher-paced quiz, so I basically say when you move on to the next question. You can also do it as a student-paced quiz,